Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Just As You Are, A Teen's Guide to Self-Acceptance and Lasting Self-Esteem by Michelle Skeen, PsyD, and Kelly Skeen. Narrated by Shaina Summerville. Publisher's Note: This publication is designed to provide accurate and authoritative information in regard to the subject matter covered. It is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering psychological, financial, legal, or other professional services. If expert assistance or counseling is needed, the services of a competent professional should be sought. Introduction. When you're feeling bad about yourself and struggling, you usually feel even worse because you feel alone with your pain. You might feel that if only someone understood your suffering, it would make you feel better. But you also know that this would involve sharing the part or parts of yourself that you are trying to hide. If you feel inadequate, deficient, defective, flawed, or failing in some way, we want you to know that you are not alone. All of us struggle with some aspect of ourselves. This feeling is reinforced and likely made worse by social media and the constant and ever-changing messages you receive about what you need to do, to look like, and to act like in order to be accepted. It can leave you feeling like you need to hide parts of yourself that aren't perfect and/or don't fit within the current societal norm. This by itself feels like a setup for failure. First, we want to explain a word that we use throughout the book. Defective. This word represents a core belief that, we believe, everyone feels to some degree. It's a feeling that something is wrong with you. This feeling is on a spectrum. You may feel this a little bit, a decent amount, or a lot. You may feel it in some areas of your life and not others, or all areas of your life. It may be something that is very specific to you, or it might be related to your family or background or community. It might be something that you feel is obvious to everyone who sees you, or it might be something that is not visibly obvious to others. Ultimately, the feeling is the same. There is something about yourself that causes you to feel shame. When you feel like parts of yourself are unacceptable, then it's likely you feel shame. And the presence of shame is preventing you from being your authentic self and developing relationships that allow for a deep connection. It can feel impossible to share the parts of yourself that you have learned to hide, because you imagine or experience consequences if or when you share them. Everyone feels this way about some part of himself or herself. It may just be something that was passed down by your family, a type of survival mechanism. Or it may be something you learned from peer interaction or societal expectations. Whatever the source, the result is the same. You are not fully living or enjoying your life. Lifelong struggles with feelings of unworthiness and inferiority begin with beliefs formed in childhood and adolescence. This book empowers teens to identify and eliminate these beliefs now, before they take root and cause problems like depression, addiction, and failed relationships in adulthood. Just As You Are gives you a way to understand your feelings and change your perception of yourself, as well as the influence of others. First, you will think about the beliefs about yourself and others that are getting in the way of living the life you want and deserve. Understanding what started this cycle of negativity is the first step in eliminating it. You will learn how to liberate yourself from these feelings of defectiveness and distorted thoughts by accepting your imperfections and accepting your whole self. You will accomplish this by identifying your values, that is, deciding what's truly important to you. When you are solid in your values, you are less likely to feel overpowered by the opinions and criticisms of others. You will then learn about compassion. Most importantly, cultivating self-compassion, along with extending compassion to others and being receptive to compassion from other people. Next, you will learn mindfulness as a tool for self-acceptance. When your self-defeating thoughts and beliefs are triggered, mindfulness can help you stay present with your current experience, rather than reacting based on past failures. With these skills, you will be prepared to understand your emotions, tolerate the discomfort they may bring, and take actions that will move you toward what's important to you. And you will learn effective communication skills so you can connect with other people in a meaningful way. All of this will allow you to be authentic and accept yourself, just as you are, and create and maintain deep connections with others. Chapter 1. What's up with the way I feel about myself? Whether you are 12 years old or 19 years old, your beliefs about yourself have already been formed by your interactions with your environment. Your environment includes everything you come in contact with: social media, family, friends, peers, your school, community, books you read, TV shows and movies you watch, magazines. You get the picture. And they all communicate or interact with you in a way that creates and reinforces your beliefs about yourself, others, and the world around you. If these early beliefs lead you to feel that you are somehow not worthy or inferior, they have the potential to become so established that they become difficult to eliminate. As you continue listening and complete the exercises in this book, you'll begin to understand and identify the negative beliefs about yourself, meet them with self-compassion, and accept yourself just as you are. The exercises in this book will help you gain insights into your experiences that can lead you to an adulthood of greater ease, confidence, and resilience in the face of all of life's ups and downs. As you might imagine, your beliefs about yourself are a mixed bag. It's likely that you have beliefs about yourself that are positive. Maybe you make friends easily, you have great hair, you are close with your siblings, you excel academically, you're good at sports, and so on. And it's also likely that you have beliefs about yourself that are negative. In fact, this might mean that you are hiding parts of yourself because you fear being judged, not accepted, or both. You may feel that you are outside of the norm in some way. There might even be aspects of your identity that you have no control over or you don't like, such as your ethnicity, religion, family, culture, height, eye color, body type. You get the point. Of course, there is even more of your life that is out of your control, because you have parental figures who control parts of your life that you have little or no say about. Where you live, what school you attend, activities you are or are not allowed to participate in, who you can be friends with, who you can date, the list goes on. And there's a good chance that you feel inadequate, flawed, or not good enough as a result of some of these factors. This book is designed to help you bring awareness to the negative beliefs that might be getting in the way of pursuing your interests, taking chances, exploring and sharing all parts of yourself, and building meaningful relationships. This new awareness includes identifying and understanding the way that your current behaviors are likely reinforcing your negative beliefs about yourself. First, you will look at the beliefs about yourself and others that are getting in the way of accepting all parts of yourself. Understanding what started this cycle of negativity is the first step in eliminating it. After you've brought awareness to your beliefs, you will learn how to handle the negative thoughts that can feel like they reinforce your negative beliefs, and you'll get the tools you need to break free from the behaviors that reinforce these feelings of defectiveness, unworthiness, failure, and inadequacy. Your negative beliefs. Every teenager, you are not alone, struggles to some extent with feelings of inadequacy, defectiveness, and unworthiness. This impacts your feelings of self-worth, which might be holding you back or getting in the way of satisfying peer interactions and acceptance. Like most people, you care about what other people think of you, and you probably spend at least some time comparing yourself to your peers. Social media feeds our natural tendency to see how we measure up to others. This can result in feeling that you are flawed, not as perfect as other people might seem. When these feelings get repeatedly reinforced over time, it can lead to shame, depression, anxiety, and isolation. We are all wired to connect with others, and when we do make healthy connections, we thrive. So it makes sense that we would want to be accepted by others and would fear being found not good enough and rejected. In fact, you may go to great lengths to avoid judgment or rejection from others. This might include seeking affirmation from others, being unable or unwilling to make decisions without approval from others, or having difficulty hearing even mild criticism. You may find it difficult to accept and share parts of yourself that are out of your control, or you may feel like you need to be a certain way in order to be liked and accepted by others. Or you may focus more of your energy on others as a way to distract them from the ways in which you feel insufficient. You may already be thinking about the parts of yourself that make you feel less than, or that you hide from others because you fear the response you might receive. And you might even be aware of the ways this holds you back from realizing your full potential or building the relationships that you long for. Let's hear stories from some teens who have shared their feelings of defectiveness and how it impacts their lives. Kamele. Kamele is the center on his high school varsity basketball team. A silent warrior, he works hard and is popular and well-liked, but he's quiet. His friends and peers take his silence as a sign that he's just cool. After all, he doesn't need to say much. He's too busy winning basketball games and being a reliable teammate and friend. Now let's hear from Kamele about his experience. I'm terrified to say much to anyone because I'm afraid that they will think I'm stupid. When I was younger and we lived in a different city, I developed a stutter. My parents sent me to a speech therapist. I was able to get rid of it for the most part over time. But when I'm nervous or stressed, it resurfaces. I remember the ridicule that I experienced when I was younger. It was so painful. There were days when I wouldn't get out of bed to go to school. Now I hide this part of myself because I am scared that I will be judged as inadequate and rejected. Kamele's external presentation as a high school basketball star is a contrast to his internal experience. This often creates a barrier for him when trying to form deeper, more authentic connections with others. We fear rejection if others see the parts of us that we experience as imperfect, inadequate, defective, or flawed. Do you worry that others will view you unfavorably if they become aware of any areas where you struggle? Gaia. Gaia is a social media star. She has thousands of Facebook friends and followers on Instagram and Snapchat. She is beautiful and clever. People can't help but like her posts. She wears the most trendy, sought-after clothes, often in interesting ways, and she always accompanies her posted photos with a clever caption. Everyone wants to either be her or be her friend. Here is Gaia's experience. Every moment of my day is preoccupied with thoughts about what I need to do to be liked. I plan out my posts on social media with excruciating detail. Most of the time, I take at least 20 selfies before I pick one that's good enough to post. Then I edit it and choose a filter that makes me look the way I want to. Once I've done that, I agonize over creating a caption to post with the photo. It's like I live in constant fear that I won't be liked by my peers. I don't really have any truly close friends because I'm afraid to let them see that my perfect posts are very different from how imperfect I feel. Gaia has carefully cultivated an image that she wants to project to others. Making constant comparisons on social media has decreased her feelings of self-worth because she feels like she needs to be viewed a particular way in order to be liked, whether on social media or in real life. The pressure of trying to maintain this false front compromises her ability to make authentic connections with others. Do you feel like you're invested in presenting yourself in a favorable light in order to be liked, and to hide parts of yourself that you don't like? Layla. Layla started seeing a psychiatrist and taking antidepressant medication when she was 10 years old. As an only child, she spent lots of time alone. Her parents began to worry that something was wrong because she didn't show an interest in spending time with her peers or engaging in activities that seemed typical of kids her age. Once she started on the medication, she became less isolated and seemed more interested in getting involved in activities with her peers. Let's hear what Layla has to say about her experience. I've been on antidepressant medication for 4 years. It really does feel like it's changed my life. And it's nice that my parents aren't worried about me all of the time. I have friends and I stay busy with activities, but I feel a lot of shame about being a crazy person who needs to be on medication. None of my friends know that I take medication to help with my depression. In fact, I put on such a happy front that they sometimes call me the cheerleader. I worry that if they ever found out that I'm crazy, they wouldn't want to be friends with me anymore. Fortunately, Layla's parents and doctor were able to identify her depression and treat it with the proper medication so she can enjoy her life. Clearly, her condition is something that is out of her control, and yet she is hiding this part of herself and her experience because she fears that she will be rejected by her peers. Do you have a medical or other condition that you hide from others? Jeff. Jeff is a good guy with a good family. He does well in school and he is good at most sports. He makes friends easily, but he never feels like he's good enough. So he goes out of his way to please people. He tells others what they want to hear. This might include things about them, himself, or other topics. Jeff can be whoever you need him to be. He just wants to make you happy. Let's hear what Jeff has to say. I live in constant fear of being criticized for not being good enough. The truth is that I feel very average. There isn't anything wrong with me. I'm a good guy. I do well in school. I'm decent at sports. I'm good in the looks department. But I've always felt like I need to be special, to stand out from the crowd. So at a young age, I started telling people what I thought they wanted to hear. It seemed to work. People liked me and wanted to be around me because I made them feel good. Now I don't even know who I am because I've been lying for so long to make other people happy and prevent them from noticing that I'm nothing special. Jeff is so busy pleasing the people around him so that they are too distracted to notice that he is as average as he feels. Over time, his habitual behaviors have caused him to lose sight of himself. And he doesn't have any authentic connections because he doesn't let anyone see him for who he really is. Do you find yourself trying to please others so that they will like you or not criticize you? Has the focus on making others happy led to losing your connection with who you are and what you care about? Panina. Panina knew from a young age that in order to make her parents happy, she needed to do well in school. Nothing less than straight A's was acceptable. In fact, they made it clear that a B was shameful. She attended the primary school that both of her highly accomplished parents attended, and despite the fact that she was unable to do A work on her own, she was accepted into a very academically competitive high school. In high school, Panina felt stressed out nearly all of the time. The work was difficult, and she tried her hardest to get the perfect grades her parents wanted. So when she didn't, she felt unsuccessful and ashamed. Panina was also afraid that her friends would think the only reason she was there was because her parents had used their influence. Let's hear what Panina has to say. My parents are really smart and accomplished. I'm sure that I'm a disappointment to them. The highly academic school I attend is out of my league. I really struggle every day. With my peers and friends, I act as if everything is great. But I lie about my grades because I don't want anyone to know that I'm a B student among all of the A students. At this school, it's not enough to be above average. You must be excellent. My parents pay for a private tutor to work with me every day after school. I lie to my friends about what I'm doing when I'm at home with my tutor, so they won't think I'm stupid. Panina is trying to please her parents and fit in academically with her peers. This makes her feel like she needs to hide the parts of herself that would reveal that she doesn't have the same academic achievements as her parents and her classmates. This leaves her feeling inadequate and unworthy. Are you in an environment that forces you to compare yourself to others? Can you identify with the struggles that Kamele, Gaia, Layla, Jeff, and Panina shared? Whether it's messages that you've received from a parent, peers, friends, or siblings, or from the bigger message that is communicated, it's clear that you must be better than everyone else in order to succeed. It's a competitive world. The pressure can feel relentless. How do you compare to the other people you are competing against? The struggle starts with comparisons to others, and before long you feel that you are lacking, inadequate, flawed, unworthy, and so on. So many of the negative beliefs we have about ourselves can be linked to comparisons to others. It can be a big distraction from our own strengths and interests, and what we value. And, as you may be starting to see, it makes us feel worse about ourselves. When we don't feel good about ourselves, it impacts all areas of our lives. During this time in your life, friendships become increasingly important. But if you feel like you aren't good enough, it is difficult to do the things that are central to making and keeping friends. Reaching out to others, sharing yourself authentically, and asserting your needs and expectations. If you believe that you are flawed, unworthy, lacking, or unlovable, you probably expect rejection, and this can make you miserable and vulnerable to abuse. You may believe that the people you care about will leave you or reject you if you don't behave in a certain way. Or you might fear that you will be criticized and made to feel worse about yourself if you don't put the needs of others before your own. Your beliefs about yourself might be holding you back in areas like academics and extracurricular activities, such as music, art, sports, because you believe that there's no point in challenging yourself, because you are doomed to fail. Now we want you to bring some awareness to the parts of yourself that you tend to hide from others. Try this. In the stories about Kamele, Gaia, Layla, Jeff, and Panina, they explained a part of themselves that they feel they need to hide for fear that they will be found lacking, unworthy, unlovable, or defective. In your journal, write your story about the parts of yourself that you hide. How does it feel to bring awareness to the part or parts of yourself that you fear will be exposed? It's likely that you feel anxious just seeing it written out. Write about this in your journal, too. Kelly.
Growing up. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.